Hello, everyone that's here live, that's here asynchronously. Welcome, welcome to Archetypal Hour, the space where we talk about archetypes, talk about forms that form, shapes that are shaping, patterns patterning. And last week we added moves that are moving, archetypal moves. I was joking with Lexi and Hoda before I hit record that I was like, I'm not sure which way this episode will go, but I was feeling a little tug from the mundane, meaning like maybe talking about some really earthbound basic type of archetypes, maybe potentially. So we'll see where it all comes up. But I think partly I was still sort of, my subconscious, I feel like, has been doing a lot of work without me being aware. But I've been thinking about those hyper-dimensional spaces Nobu talked about in his last Why Am I Like This? So I'm feeling like those spaces are coming up in my mind. Hey, Chris, welcome, welcome. For those that have never joined, Chris, if you've never been in this space before, a lot of times how we like to start is just seeing what things are coming up for you in your field, in your life that you're noticing. Maybe there's certain archetypes that or certain forms or shapes or patterns or sort of deities, characters, whatever, that seem to be just sort of resonant for you, that feel maybe alive, that are capturing your attention, or maybe you feel them sort of like tugging at you from the periphery. Like, you know, I've seen this, you know, whatever it was. I've seen a blackbird 3 times this week, and I'm trying to make sense of it. So at any level, you know, just like to start that way to see what has been coming up, what has been showing up, what has been recurring in your field or recurring in your body mind. So we'll start there. I'll leave some, hold some space while everyone starts thinking about it. I'm actually going to think about it too. Like what has been coming up for me lately?
Can I go whenever?
Please. Yeah, please jump in. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, cool. First of all, thank you for opening this space and holding it for me. I really appreciate that. Really grateful. Lately, a lot of the archetypes and motifs that I've been experiencing having to do with integrity, preservation, direction, you know, the father, the son, because, you know, there's also the receiver and the transmitter. You know, I'm thinking about the sun as far as assertion, like, you know, shining light on things. Then there's the moon, where's the reception of things, and also reflection, internal, external, really being able to look at the feedback loop, and like really apply the cheat sheet, because at this point it's not like we don't have all the information at our fingertips. So it's like, okay, well, if I recognize this pattern, what does this mean, and how can I apply it in ways that will yield a fruit, especially in a certain timetable? Because now, you know, you think about how long something might take to grow or to perish. It's like, okay, well, now I can include that in my plan. Like, when should I start? When shouldn't I? Especially when you think about let that boy cook. It's like one of those things. Like, all right, well, how long does it take to cook something? Do you want it? Do you want it undercooked, or do you want it well done? Do you want it rare, or do you want it, you know, well done? So it's like. Sometimes, like, some people might leave it on the back burner too long and it might get burnt, but, you know, it's also about just being mindful. So, you taking orders? I don't know what that means. What does that mean?
I think she meant in the kitchen. Like, you taking, oh, if you're in the archetypal kitchen, you're taking orders.
Okay, you know I'm taking orders, and I'm seasoning it real well. I got all the flavors, what you like. I'm just having fun with it too, though. Like, in that context, you know, I'm really, I like to think of myself as a culinary artist, not even a chef. I like to, you know, I'm playing around with it and having fun and really enjoying it. And There goes that inner child again, like the child, the father. So being able to have some sort of discipline, but, you know, coloring within those lines, like, you know, it's like you see a picture in a coloring book of a sun. It's like the sun doesn't have to be yellow. It can be red or blue if I wanted to, type thing. So I'm just finding images and templates and presets for, you know, parameters that I enjoy, things, shapes that I like, colors that I like, and kind of mismatching them. And you know, I have an idea of what I want my life to look like and feel like, and I'm also considering the time it takes for these things to happen, and applying what I know, and kind of going from there. Like, you know, because when it comes to that other side of asserting yourself, it's like you also have to be. You have to assert the reception of something. It's like sometimes people have a hard time going to sleep because they feel so active. But, you know, then there's like that balance where it's like, oh, I feel so active. I'm going to try consciously to go to sleep. I'm going to lay here and focus so hard on not moving that maybe I'll just become unconscious type
thing.
So, there's a level of intensity to it, especially when it comes to dedication and focus and clarity. Because at a certain point, certain things become self-sabotage when you know that you want to live a certain way, or you know that certain things are at stake, and you know what you're willing to compromise and what you're not willing to compromise for. So, you know, it becomes a thing where it's like, okay, I might have to put Delta S, shout out to Saturn, you know, might have to whip this into shape, you know, and really fill it in with colors and shades that I like.
Woo! Thank you, Chris. There's a lot there. I'm like looking at my notes, trying to let's do some weaving. Let's see what pops up for all the other folks and see which direction to go. But I love that you brought us into like the archetypal kitchen right now. I feel like.
Yeah.
Right. So we're in the kitchen. You talked about lots of different spices and different archetypes that you're playing with. I like what you said in the beginning about like weaving this integrity and preservation and directiveness. And so you were like really feeling drawn to archetypes, shapes, sort of ways of being that allow your integrity or that preservation and that direction to come out. You mentioned the father and the son, also the sun and the moon. And I think you were, I thought it was really cool. Like, I don't think you used the term masculine and feminine, but I thought you were doing some really interesting.
Yeah, that was implied.
Yeah, it was like implied, like that blending of like that more like directive, kind of propulsive, setting direction, kind of, which is often like thought of as more masculine and more like being receptive and being more reflective, right? Which might be sometimes considered more like a feminine archetype. I also really was drawn to like the feedback loop, like this idea of like trying to build that feedback loop where it's sort of the energy keeps coming. And then I like that we were talking about like apply the cheat sheet, like, you know, you were also talking a lot about like almost like integration, like, yo, I've been doing a lot now. It's like, it's almost like if we were to stay with the archetypal kitchen, it sounded like you were like, oh man, I got some dope spices, I got some fresh ingredients, you know, I got some ideas, I got some recipes.
Yeah,
what am I cooking up? Like, I gotta do it. Yeah And like, I'm going to get to work. Like, you invoke Saturn too. Like, I'm going to do the hard work. Like, yeah, this thing might be a kind of a pain in the ass to make, but when it's done, whoo, everyone's happy. I'm happy. Everyone's satisfied, you know?
You know, and then when you savor something that tastes so good and you put some love in that bitch, put your foot in it, like, yeah, I really did this. Like, that's one of those things that's like so hard to I want to say substitute with something that's so much less satisfactory. Like, it just doesn't make sense to do it any other way once you have it that one way. It's like spoiled. And I wanted to say hello to Tiff while I'm on the mic.
Yeah, and I love while we're in this kitchen too, like, I think I love what you said about like how when you really spend the time on something, like the dividends, the sort of the payoff is huge sometimes. And like, I feel like that applies to so many things, whether you're working on some kind of manifestation in your life, or you're working on bringing an idea or a piece of art or creativity to life, or like legit, just literal meal to life. Like, I love that you're drawing us our attention to sort of these archetypes of like care and intentionality and allowing the process to unfold to get something really cool on the other end. Whew.
Thanks again for letting me share. I appreciate it.
Yeah, please. Thank you for sharing. I want to check in with the other folks, especially if there's something that Chris said or something that we've talked about that also has felt like it's been in your field or something you've been considering, but also maybe there's something that sort of feels totally unrelated. Bring that in too. Like, let's open it up and see what's in the mix among this group. And feel free to come off of mute or throw it in the chat, whatever feels more comfortable for you. But we're in the archetypal kitchen. I grew up in an Italian-Irish household in Jersey, so my kitchen was loud. We were talking over each other, but it was all love.
What part of Jersey?
North Jersey. Morris County.
You said Italian and what?
An Irish family, yeah.
Oh. That sounds really rich.
Yeah, it was fun. It was fun. A lot of, like I said, a lot of high volume conversations.
A lot of animated people.
Yes, exactly. Like, not afraid to be animated and emotional and dramatic.
Yeah,
you know, sure. Which I love. But yeah, what's going on with everyone? Let's see. Ooh, Tiff says, in terms of kitchen related archetypes, I'm in the prep phase. And I feel like this kind of relates when you said the prep phase, and I thought of prep, like, because I've worked in kitchens before, of course. And like, I also couldn't help but remember another archetypal hour container where you were like, where the chef's knife came up for you. And like, I'm like, yeah, that prep work with the knife. Like, oof, are you in the back doing knife work, getting your stuff all lined up? Boop, 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 boop.
Yep, exactly that. I used to work in a kitchen back like maybe 4 or 5 years ago, 3, 4, and it was a fast food kitchen. But I was on prep, and we had to chop the day's worth of tomatoes and onions and pickles and crap for all the burgers. And I'm just like, that's my favorite thing to do. Just like zone out. I don't have to take orders. I'm just chopping onions and then I'm just chopping tomatoes. And like, that's where I'm at right now. Like the next month or so is going to be like doing the work on the fly, but I'm going to have everything set up. I'm working on setting everything up now.
Mm. Wow. That sounds so potent. And it feels really does feel related to what Chris was talking about too. I feel like, putting that work in and letting that process be. And I love what you're talking about, kind of like how meditative that can be when you're doing the prep work. And I know what you're talking about. You get into this like the zones kind of space. That's awesome. And so you're feeling like that's the phase you're in right now. That's a beautiful thing. Anything else you want to share on it? Is it like music related, or what would you say you're prepping, or is it more like just life stuff, life moves? Could be combination. I'm just curious.
I mean, maybe mainly life moves, I guess. Mm-hmm. I don't prep music as much as I used to, but like Ramadan's coming up, so I'm not sure if I know how to not eat for 30 days. So I'm trying to practice. You gotta read 30 pages or 20 pages of the Quran every day. And I'm like, I can barely read one. So I'm like brushing up on my Arabic, like giving myself the mental stamina to get through a whole page, trying times it by 20. I'm not there yet, but you know, it's like all these little things. I'm like, all right, I don't really know. I've dabbled in it, but I'm like, what if I hit the ground running? What if I legitimately tried? So like we went with you know, kitchen, but I was kind of feeling more like when you like a kid and you get bad grades or something, and your parents be like, you smart, you should just apply yourself. So I'm like, all right, what if I actually tried instead of, like, I'm always on that, no pressure, we'll get to it, we'll cross that bridge when we get to it. But, like, you're supposed to say that, like, I feel like I'm supposed to say that the way my life is set up. I'm supposed to say that to myself after I fail at something, because I don't really be trying sometimes. So this time, I'm like, I'm going to try. I'm going to give it a try.
I think that's so important. I have to interject because definitely I feel like that's why those particular archetypes that I had started off with are so prevalent, because at a certain point, you definitely recognize the balance between trying and not trying, because you should, of course, be living a life where it's like a low effort, like high output type thing, where I shouldn't have to try to be myself. I shouldn't have to try to, like, find ways to express myself outside of what comes naturally. But then you look at what your limitations are when you try to do that, like things that stop you from expressing yourself unapologetically, I guess, for lack of a better term. And so that's where, for me, those things have been coming in, especially because I've grown up with a lot of those affirmations, like, you should try, like, you're so smart, you should apply yourself. Then it's like, okay, then I've even grown up with shit like, you don't listen. But it's one of those things where it's like, okay, now I have to test this, like reality test this. Like, okay, what the reality ended up being was I listened to everything that you've ever told me. And then I did the math, and then I did what made sense. So then it becomes, okay, well, I don't listen. No, what it really is I don't obey, because what it is that you suggested I should do doesn't make sense. So now it's like, okay, well, what does make sense for me? And then that's where the father, the direction, stuff like that comes in, the son, because now I have to shine a light on the path which would illustrate or indicate that I am walking that walk that says, or that demonstrates that I know who I am, and I know what I want, and I know why I want it, and I know how I'm going to get it, and I know when I'm going to get it, type thing. So it's like, okay, how do I get to a place where I get to express myself freely without having to worry about any negative outcomes or undesirable outcomes? How do I get to this place where I get to release myself of everything that said I couldn't be who I already am, type thing? And, you know, that's how I got to even develop and cultivate a relationship with these archetypes. So, you know, I really appreciate what you said, Tiff. Like, that really spoke to me deeply.
Yeah. I love what Hoda just said in the chat, too. She said, reprogramming 101. And yes, sort of reprogramming those voices that we've heard that were maybe telling us things that just wasn't really for us, with our own voice, with our own darn self. And also, I feel like kind of one of that big piece that felt like such a beautiful bridge that I think, Chris, I think you picked up on from Tiff, was that phrase, apply yourself. And like, I feel like that's kind of juicy if anyone feels like they want to share about what that phrase or what comes up for them when they think about, like, apply yourself. Because I think even just, I'm even like breaking it up, like, there's sort of the archetype of it in, like, especially, like, I feel like, I don't know if everyone, but it sounds like everyone's, like, from that American context of, like, you should apply yourself. Like, this idea that you hear sometimes of, like, reaching your potential. But you have so much potential if you just applied it. And I've definitely heard that before, and it's like, dang, that does kind of feel like a knife sometimes. And requires some, like, resolution and some unprogramming from that kind of stuff. Oh, wow. I'm seeing a lot of, yeah, so let me just stop talking or invite people to jump off and, like, yeah, let's open this can of worms up about what we think apply yourself means, both sort of what maybe people have said it means and, like, what we want to, like, reclaim as what it really should mean.
Yeah. Oh, my gosh. The potential thing. I feel like this is so, like, central to, like, a lot of like Hoda mentioned, reprogramming, like the reprogramming that I have to do personally, because I feel like there's a lot of ways where like that kind of messaging about like, well, you have so much potential, Anna, or like just apply yourself. Like for a long time, I feel like I was sort of like rebelling against that. And so it's like I had to like turn around all the way and just like tune it out completely. But now I'm like getting to this place where I'm like, well, how can I like actually integrate the perspective of like applying myself, like not for other people, not for like my friends, not for my parents, not for, you know, like society's expectations, but like for me.
For yourself.
Like for me, you know, and like that's hard because I feel like it requires like having to like weed through everybody else's expectations and not give a fuck about them, you know, like, yeah. And that does really feel like Saturn work to me. Of like weeding through. Luna's about to start opening my cabinets. I can hear her. Sorry if you can hear it.
That's all right. She's invited.
But yeah, it's just like that Saturn work of like, I'm showing up for myself, not because other people want me to show up.
I have to come back again because that is so important. Like, that is so key because once, or at least in my experience, I'm only going to talk from my experience so everybody knows moving forward. But in my experience, it's just like, okay, there's like a level of pride that you end up having to face because once you start applying yourself to things that you want to apply yourself to, especially like when you, for me personally, that the awareness of wanting to apply myself came when I decided that I wanted something, and it was so frustrating for me to not get it because it's like I know exactly what I want and I know why I want it, and it's breaking my heart that it's not here right now. And it was like, damn. So people were right when they said I have potential. They didn't know exactly how to say it, but I know what they mean now, because it becomes like the pride, or okay, let's say that the pride comes in once you start realizing that people are cheering you on or celebrating you for materializing the things that you want, and you start getting irritated, or there might be like a feeling of anger, like, why are you cheering me on? I'm not doing this for you. But then it's like, wait, like, this doesn't mean that I shouldn't keep doing it even though they're cheering me on, because of the fact that I am actually doing what it is that I want. So then it, like, that's where you start seeing like where the confusion in yourself was, because now it's like, okay, people are cheering me on for doing what I want to do when I'm so used to associating people with cheering me on or like wanting me to move forward in ways that they wanted me to and ways that followed me. So now it's like, okay, now I have to get this confusion out of the way, because now I'm at a point in my life where people are only going to cheer me on when they see me doing what I want to do.
Hold up. I'm sorry if I'm cutting anyone off that wanted to say something, but Hoda, I'm seeing you make some comments. I'm like, I would love to get your perspective if you want.
Yes. Well, first of all, I was commenting on how I feel like Chris is speaking my mind, and I'm like, I hate it here, jokingly, of course. But I also am relating so heavily to like what Anna said and like what Tiff said, what all y'all are saying, because like to me, I feel that, and I have been noticing, first of all, like this desire, like this really, really strong desire to like reprogram all of those moments where people have cheered me on to do shit that I didn't want to do, and like reprogram that into like sincere devotion. which is kind of like what I'm hearing and a little bit of like what we're all saying, because I kind of grew up as a child who was like the poster child for like my family's success. So like my parents are immigrants. And so like they speak to their family abroad often. And like one thing that every family member who lives abroad often does is kind of like brag on their kids when they're speaking to people from back home, right? And my mom, yeah, so like my mom and dad would always use my accomplishments as like, look at how good we're doing in America type thing, which was super, I guess like now in hindsight, it's like super sweet and probably their version of like sincerity. But at the same time, I felt like that pressure, especially like in my mid-20s of being like, well, like my dad thinks that I should be the successful lawyer. My mom thinks that I could be like the principal of some school. And like, I just want to like be an artist. Like I want to be a spiritualist. I want to be a shamanist and I want to be a prophetess. And like, how does that fit into what they want for me? And it didn't. It actually didn't. And so like, I had to kind of like decouple the like density of their determinism and kind of like transmute that into like devotion to myself and like kind of like understand that like maybe my parents and other people, right, are like not wrong about my potential, but like in internalizing my own ideation and an ability to like apply myself to something, internalizing that as what I see my potential as, and like understanding that like the potential that I have, like the wellspring of creativity that I want to like share with the world, is actually an extension of my relationship to source. Like, for lack of better words, like the reason why I even have this much potential is because like my being is divine. And so it's like, and that's not like ego, like not that my ego self is divine, like my soul is divine. And so getting to that place has taken a lot of work. I was also saying in the chat that I'm still in my Saturn return. So, you know, my vibe about this might change, but I'm happy to to share this with you guys. So thanks for the opportunity to reflect.
Woo! I love that. I love that. And something about the way that you, maybe it's because I'm from past conversations and I have some weird associations in my body mind, but like, something about the way you were weaving that story with the potential, and I'm like combining it with what everyone else has been saying too. And it almost feels like if we were to think of like this potential, like in like quantum physics terms, where this sort of cloud of potential, of particles, of all this quantum swirling energy, and in that quantum field, their shapes come into life, and there's like the shapes that are projected onto us. And then there's the shapes that are actually coming from the deepest part of us, that divine part that you were talking about, Hoda, the soul. And how, like, in this sort of space that we'll call the future, maybe, or the unfolding present moment, there's sort of this need to do that work to clean, because the projections are adding to us. We're kind of using our sense of fear or whatever's coming up from all the pressure that we're receiving from our family, from societal needs and obligations, and there you have this really murky area where you don't know what's going to come to life, or sometimes nothing really comes to fruition. And so I'm kind of like going back to some of the stuff that I think you were talking about, Chris, of like that clarity, that intentionality of like, ooh, and then just like you were mentioning, Hoda, on everybody, like this reprogramming, so that the potential, the things that want to manifest in the world through us, have their ability to. Because we're helping to sort of clean that space of potential. Anyway, that's what came up for me when I was hearing you all. I'm curious if that lands with anyone, but wow, this is really exciting. I'm curious if anyone else has more they want to say on this piece especially, and applying yourself.
I wanna elaborate what I said about like how I picture just I take things a little literally. Like that's my flaw / superpower, where they'll be like, Tiff, apply yourself. And I'm like, what does that really mean? And then I'll see like commercials like head on, apply directly to the forehead. So like, it's like you put something onto something. So I'm like, what, like just lay myself across this math homework and okay. But no, like really just like an energetic term, like applying myself, like putting myself onto this thing. So like whatever the concept is, like, you know, getting better grades or playing music or whatever, like practice your instrument or whatever, or be in the kitchen, like chef it up, cut the stuff perfectly, like you got some sense, you know how to cut. Essentially, I would just be always like, I know I can do it. So like, who am I? What am I proving to anyone? Or like, I probably could do it if I tried, but I don't feel like trying. So it's whatever. But like applying myself, like that becomes my thing. Like I've imprinted onto it my approach and my energy to doing the thing. So now that's like, Tiff did the music. This is Tiff's homework. Tiff got the good grades because, you know, it's like I'm connecting myself to it essentially. That's what I think of in terms of apply yourself. Like, go ahead and connect with it, or what is it? Entangle? I don't know.
I feel like that's so accurate. I think that's so important to consider too, because I feel like good grades doesn't look the same for everybody. Like it might like the standard good grades might be for like poor cars and all that, but like with the things that you're doing in life, are you getting the grades that you want? Like, is this a high grade product? Like, am I trying the hardest that I can with like the things that I want to do? Like, I think that's so interesting to like, cause like applying yourself, like I think about like, okay, I'm not trying to prove anything to anybody for any reason, but then it's like, okay, I do want this one thing. So like, I don't know. I think that highlights a really interesting relationship with like desire and wanting and lack as archetypes, because then it's like, okay, why don't I have this thing? And who's to say that my ability to materialize things externally is lacking because of this thing that I think I want. Like, I recently had an experience where I just like was like, damn, I may never go to sleep again. And I was like, no, fuck that, I'm gonna go to sleep. And then I'm like trying to go to sleep and I'm like, wait, fuck, I may never wake up again. And so I sat up and looked around me and I was like, damn, like I really did this. I'm so grateful to be here, and really like just patting myself on the back for accomplishing everything that I've done up until this point. Fuck that point, this point. And and that brings me back around to my point where it'd be like, okay, you should apply yourself. You have so much potential, but then it's like, how disrespectful of you to ever say something like that to me, to assume that I'm not applying myself, to assume that I haven't done the work to do what it is that I'm doing or behave the way that I'm behaving. Like, are you envious that my life doesn't look the way that it does? What about my life makes you want to have this? In fact, I may be able to teach you something about how to be how I am if you were just to listen, as opposed to telling me that I should do more work to become like you.
Yeah. When people say that potential stuff, when I start going down that path, it's like, I think what you really mean is I'm not conforming to your expectations. That's quite different than my potential. What the hell you know about my potential?
I was just agreeing with you, and I was harping off that because I'm thinking too about the idea of luxury, the archetypes of luxury and leisure and patience, and how much patience is a luxury. Like, to be able to, like, leisure, like, just to be able to kick your feet up and just relax. It's so hard for so many people. I've learned that in my experience. It's like so hard for so many people to just relax because they feel like there's something that they have to do all the time. And it's like, okay, what makes you feel like that?
Yes. I'm going to read something from the chat here, too. Tiff says, the way that people can't fathom my full potential and how taking their prescribed path isn't going to get me where I'm going. That's the thing. They don't see what we're seeing. Wow. And then, yeah, Poda saying, I'm trying to get to know that archetype of luxury. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And I do think what you're saying, like, I think culturally, you're right. Like, leisure is something that does not come naturally. I think what we confuse leisure with is consumption and entertainment. But that's not really leisure, is it? At least from my opinion.
Specifically because you got to work for those things. Like, why do I have to work for leisure when I could just actually sit here and enjoy everything that I already have?
Yep. Yep. Why? Why? I also, when you were talking about desire, I'd also like realized that that was coming up in my field lately too. I mean, I was, as you, some of you know, I was obsessed with the myth of Psyche and Cupid. Cupid also like a sort of the Roman version of Eros. And I was listening to this lecture about Logos versus Eros, and then he was also bringing in this third piece of passivity. And I was really, I like what you said though, but like, I was thinking about how that relates to some of the things that were in my field with like, even the way you were just talking about like the direction versus like the want. Like to me, like, I think that kind of is what's being said with like Logos as like this, this is the plan, this is the reason, the rationale behind it, sort of what I would say, like a lot of the father archetype that you were talking about, I think in my mind also speaks to this Logos. And then, like, the Eros, this desire, like, what is actually just bubbling up? And how can I get these things aligned? My Logos and my Eros, my desire and sort of my mental, like, oh, I see where I'm going and I want, now I'm able to connect these dots. And it looks like there's some conversation about the Saturn return happening in the chat. And I think Saturn is a really important player in this. I'm so glad that Saturn keeps coming up, and I'm glad that you keep bringing up, Chris, especially, but others too, like the importance of the putting the work in. I mean, that's one of those things that I always appreciated about Saturnian energy. Like Saturn might, I'm trying to even think of the words because I just think Saturn just like speaks for itself almost, but like, you know, Saturn is where so much of the gifts, I think, can come from, but we do get scared of Saturn. We do get scared of the work. We do get scared of the limitations and the constriction. But damn, if Saturn doesn't come out, the diamond out of the coal, right? The, you know, that beautiful thing that needed time, that needed pressure.
Like the pressure of necessity, literally. Right. I think about it in the context of putting in the work to relax. Literally, how I was saying earlier, sometimes it's like hard to go to sleep. Some people can just turn up the intensity on the focus of going to sleep. How much focus do you have? Like that, I feel like that's actually a really good test of focus. Like, how long can you stay still? Like, how long can you, like, be quiet? Like, shut the fuck up. Like, how long can you really listen and, like, really receive your environment before you feel like you have to assert yourself? Like, how good is your focus to just, like, embrace the moment? I feel like that's really exemplary of, like, your relationship with yourself.
Yeah, I like how you're combining that with like, yeah, how that kind of actually allowing silence, actually being receptive and actually like listening active, like listening with your whole body kind of stuff. I love that. And also it goes back to like, for some reason I'm feeling back to like how Tiff was talking about like the literal applying, like I'm putting it on. And it's almost like, as she said that, I was like, yeah, it's almost like you're sort of applying yourself, the shapes and the sort of energy that is yourself in that moment, and you're applying it to the context that you're in. You're applying it to your environment. You're applying it to whatever thing you're working on or event that's occurring or what, like you said, what's happening in that real moment. Hmm.
Wow.
Ooh, I like that. Hook says, gnosis to me is what arises from reception. That's refined, a refined reception. That is a beautiful little definition of gnosis. Mm. And Tiff says, that brings me back to the quote, your presence is a gift. Ooh. It is. It is a gift.
Yeah, like I said before, I think I've said it before in here, but yeah, like me being present in situations, like it just gives me the ability to respond in a way that might be unique to me and might be needed for the situation that nobody else noticed. Because, like, you know, everybody's living their life. They got their own main character activities going on. And so, like, a lot of times I'm like a background character, but like, if I just chill and observe, and like, I'll notice something. And so like, that's like, you know, I'm applying myself to the environment and in the way I can be of use. I can, it's now my environment because I'm paying attention to it.
I'm so sorry, but for some reason, the way you describe this dynamic, I was thinking about how, like, in fiction, and especially, like, TV shows where there's, like, I've always loved those shows that are able to, like, show this sort of ensemble cast of characters where they're off doing their own thing. Like you said, they're their sort of main character in their own stories. They're kind of taking their lumps, getting their lessons, getting their learnings in. And then there's that part of the show or the season where finally all these characters meet into some big event. And you can start to see, like, oh, now I know why these characters are all meeting in this way, like how they're all bringing that unique flavor of their experience, of their information to this event. And they're bringing something unique. Like, I love the show Lost, right? Where, like, they had all these back stories where you'd see them on the island and, like, how are they dealing with this crazy, you know, experience that they're all having? And then we would go back and see what they were like before the island. And it was this beautiful way, I think, of articulating something that is true in real life, where we're bringing these unique stories, both cosmic and earthbound and ancestral stories, and we're resolving these stories and we're taking our lumps and we're learning and we're growing and we're stretching and all that. And then we're coming into these events where, to use like language of using the broom, where suddenly karma has ripened and now it comes turn to see, okay, what do we have, right? And I think those kinds of shows also show a lot about character, because I think about that a lot too, where it's like, damn, I might think I got some cool shit going on. I got some right beliefs and I've got nice morals and I've got kind of some courage I've built up or whatever, or some perspective that's worth something. But maybe that all evaporates in a split second in some crazy moment where I got to really collect myself and see what goes and apply myself to that environment. And so for some reason that kind of came up as I hear you talking, because I love what you're saying about, like, especially that uniqueness too of like, how do I bring this unique, my unique gift, talent, perspective, my unique energies into this moment? And sort of, there's sort of this sense of like, ah, oh, that's why that can come that afterwards. That's such a wonderful feeling, both as like an audience member watching a show, but like, especially in real life when you're like, oh, I'm seeing it now. Especially when you start getting into this stuff more, I feel like you start looking back at old events in your life and you're like, I kind of know why I was in that room now. I kind of know why I was at that workplace. I kind of know why I was there. I kind of know why I'm in this family, you know, and those things, they start to make sense over time. But like you said, if we do the hard work, and as Hoda said, the refinement to really get to know like who we really are before and after all the programming that's added onto us and all the projections that are added onto us.
Okay, so here's where the circle comes in, because
first of all, that's what we are right now. It's like all these background characters like coming together in one place where it's like, okay, this makes too much sense. And I'm in this family for this reason. So then it's like, again, the direction, the masculinity, the fire, the yang of it all, where it's like, okay, now I'm an authority figure. I'm the author of this. I'm the one constructing the narrative. And that's because I know who I am, and I know what I'm doing here, and I know why I'm here. I know what character I am, and I know what I would do, and I know what I wouldn't do, and especially in the context of people getting you out of character type thing, where it's like, oh, maybe I should stay in character type. So it's like, okay, well, that being said, like, now I get to literally talk myself into the position where I have the most desirable experience that I know I can have. So I'm about to get off here, but I just wanted to leave you guys with like the challenge to like find luxury and leisure in your experience. Like, really attempt to focus on the things that allow you the most rest, the things that allow you to sleep easy, and really find out why that is, and then start embedding that into everything that you do. And I feel like that would be really beneficial, fruitful exercise for you guys. But yeah, I'm out.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you for joining, and thank you for that beautiful challenge and exercise. I love that. Luxury, leisure, rest.
See you guys.
See you. Whew. Yeah, I'm wondering if anyone does, while that's still like up there, if anyone wanted to share any reflections on either Chris's challenge or my little rant, or what's coming up for you.
I would like to share what's coming up. What came up for me when you asked, when you mentioned like why am I in this family? Mm. And I was like thinking about like my position in my family as like a oldest daughter, and like I have been running from this position for quite some time, but like, and now I'm at my big age where like I'm probably like, okay, so basically my parents would tell me like, oh, Tiff, you're the trailblazer. And I would just be like doing my own thing, like trying new stuff out. And like whatever I picked, I'm the first one to do it. So, yeah, I get it. Trailblazer. But like, I'm a scared individual 9 times out of 10. So I'm like not going to do the things, a lot of the things. So I was like shocked to find out that they see me as like such an adventurous title as trailblazer. But then I lean into that, you know, I'm like, all right, it's whatever. Like, no one's done it before, but I can do it. And then also there's this title that they said, my mom will say, like, you're the glue that holds us together. And I'm like, that's a lot of pressure. Like, I'm not trying to hold nothing. I'm barely holding myself together. You know this. But like, yeah, not like now I'm just like, okay, well now like I can be the I have to be the trailblazer. I have to blaze a trail for myself so I can be the glue, because if I fall apart, they fall apart. So I'm like, I can choose myself as a, like I'm like going more, applying myself essentially to what I want to do, and not just like what you know, the various goals that they all have in mind for me. So that was that's something I haven't really like thought about a lot, but now I'm thinking about it a lot, like as I'm venturing into new things, and I'm like, oh, what will my family think? Oh, I don't know. But at the end of the day, like if it's keeping me sane in the midst of whatever they got going on, it's going to be a value eventually. So it don't matter what they say, or like it's none of their business from jump. So if they find out about it eventually, that's cool. But I'll be like, well, you see how beneficial it's been. So there's that. So yeah, blazing the trail, being the glue, holding it together.
Mm.
That's why I'm here.
Just to add to these archetypes of bringing things together and sort of blazing the trail a little bit. I kind of think of the bass the same way a little bit, in that the bass is what's moving our feet, and it's the glue, that bass and drum line. That's that holds the whole down, right? Wow, I love that. I also really like, Kip, when you were talking, like, to me, it felt so beautiful. Like, this conversation feels really beautiful because I feel like the full range of almost, like, the paradoxical quality of some of this is in the air, where it's, like, we're all saying that, like, the power of not being bound to the projections and the things that people put on us, while simultaneously remaining refined and open and receptive, because sometimes they'll say things and we'll say, shit, I didn't realize that, but I guess I have been blazing trails. Huh. I guess I have really been playing a little bit of that glue role. What would it look like if I were to maybe be even more intentional about this part that I'm already playing kind of naturally, but without, you know, necessarily thinking of it that way? So, like, I kind of like how we're talking about it, where it's like, it's never a clean cut thing. It's like, do only what you kind of feel, or, you know, don't listen to people or this. It's more like, it's all the above. It's all about refinement. It's all about context. It's all about doing the work to figure out what pieces are worthwhile and you take with you, or you look at yourself a new way, and what pieces you say, no, that's your stuff. That's your stuff. You keep that over there. Hmm. The position you were running from is really interesting. She says, right, how did I end up choosing the musical position I was running from? Yeah. That's a really interesting thing when you feel.
Yeah, because like bass, I chose bass because lead guitar is usually like the most popular, like the star of the thing. And I'm like, I don't feel like doing all of that. I don't want to learn all the high energy, melodious, you know, shredding activities. But like, it's all like, okay, I can play bass. That's just, you know, a little boom, boom, boom here and there. But no, now I'm like, I'm being flashy with it because it's useful. You know where to use it. But like, even as a background, like, yeah, most of the time people will ignore the bass player, but like, it's such an important position. Like, they'll ignore the bass player until the bass player messes up, and everybody knows like something is wrong.
Yep.
So it's like, that's a lot of pressure to have put on myself. But
yep.
Why was I running from such like, if everywhere else in life, like being the most important thing, because I don't like the pressure of it. And then I end up there anyways, like in multiple aspects of life. So now I'm just accepting it. It is what it is. We're going to be here. We're going to apply ourselves, and we're going to do a good job at it instead of just running.
Woo. Woo. And I think a lot goes to like the definition of importance too. Like, you know, it's like, it might seem like you said, like the flashier part seems more important, but like, actually it's all important. It's just playing the role is important. The diversity of all the roles is the important part. Whew. Hoda, I know you said something's been huge for you. Anna, please. Please come off mute. Jump in there, Anna. I saw it. No worries if not. Now that you put me on the spot, exactly. Me, Ann and I were joking too about like, sometimes we got that fire Aries thing where it's like, just don't tell me to do it. Please. Like, hint around it, but don't tell me, like, do this thing. I'm like, now I have this weird urge not to do it. Ugh. Hilarious. But, Hoda, I did also notice that you said that something's been huge for you too, but I couldn't remember which part that was from the chat. I don't know if you can recall, but wanted to open an invite to see if you recall what part was feeling really big and juicy to you. Yeah, I forgot. No, no worries. It'll come back if it needs to. If it doesn't, all good. Wow. I'm just really still thinking about, like, I also have the song Pressure now from Encanto in my head. As you all know, there's always some sort of Disney Pixar reference, it seems like, every Archetypal Hour. And just the way we've been talking about family dynamics and the pressure, I think of that song, Pressure. Wow, I love the glue. I also, like, one of my favorite archetypes when it comes to glue is the glial cell, G-L-I-A-L. this idea that, like, thank you for the gift, Tiff. But, like, one of my favorite things I remember hearing, and then again, some of this stuff, you know, you hear these things and you're like, is this actually scientifically true, or was this sort of like, you know, something that became a myth that we followed? But there was some story I had read once where it said they had, like, studied Albert Einstein's brain, like the physical brain, which, again, to me feels like really just kind of stupid from, like, a modern perspective of, like, he's so smart, it must just be this physical organ. Like, heaven forbid we think bigger about what intelligence might be. But anyway, they were looking and studying his brain. They're like, what's different about this dude's brain? And what I recall from this was they couldn't really find anything majorly different other than potentially more of these glial cells. And these are not neurons. These are not brain cells. These are sort of like the other, these are other things that are facilitating the communication between brain cells. So the idea that, like, these glial cells aren't necessarily coming up with independent thoughts or impulses or things, that they're facilitating the communication within the brain, that they're these sort of, it's like almost like a medium that the information is flowing through. And I always like that from, like, a glial cell standpoint. Oh, thank you for putting something in there. Yes. Yes. It says, glia, also known as glial cells, are non-neuronal cells in the central nervous system, brain and spinal cord, and the peripheral nervous system that do not produce electrical impulses. They make up more than one half the volume of neural tissue in our body. They maintain homeostasis, blah, blah, blah. And so, yes, interesting. They're not really producing electrical activity, but they're making electrical activity possible. They're like the delivery guys. I like that, Tiff. Yes. She says, oh, yeah, because the brain cells don't actually touch. Yes. The myelin. Yeah. So, like, it seems like some of these archetypes are juicy for some of you all, too. And it says, I relate to glia cells in that case, too, then. Yeah. I always have, too. It's a kind of understated thing. Especially in a family dynamic, but also in a group dynamic. And I love that, like, they saw that in you, Tiff. Because there's just a lot of people don't play those parts. They're so focused on their part. They're so focused on their ego perspective that it really is sometimes a rare thing for people to be able to step outside and say, okay, let me just help the facilitation, the flow of energy. You know, I can play that part too. Yeah. Hoda says, I feel like some people are built as nervous system regulators. And then she goes, regulators! Mound up. Oh, man. A channel. Yeah. Mound up! Oh, man. Nah, I just got regulators in my head. Whew. Hoda, do you want to say anything more? But I don't know. Something about the way you said some people are, like, built-in regulators, system regulators, is that's up. That's what's up. I like that. I feel like Yeah, please.
No, yeah, I agree. Sorry, go on.
No, that was it.
Yeah, I was going to say that I feel like that. I really relate to that. As Tiff was kind of, like, getting into it, I was like, you know, I kind of, like, see myself as that, and, like, my family has said that as well, about me being, like, sort of like the emotional glue. But it's interesting because, like, there's my family is very girl heavy. Like, I only have one brother, and so, like, I often can't even tell if it's just me that's just the regulator, or, like, if my other sisters take on that role. And I'm not saying that it has to be, like, a girl-centered thing at all, because I also feel like my brother plays that role sometimes when, like, things get heated among us. And so, of course, from, like, the metaphysical lens of somebody who, like, does work in this kind of way, I think about it often, like, what kind of gifts, to, like, use y'all's word and, like, the word that we were kind of invoking earlier, like, do other family members offer with their presence? And sometimes, like, a lot of the times, actually, it's, like, nervous system regulation. Like, I think of one of my sisters who And I don't want to like be egregoric about this, but she has a lot of like earth placements in her chart. And like sometimes when I'm just like around her or like I hear her voice, and I'm very like fiery and watery. And so like when I hear her voice, it instantly grounds me. And like sometimes my mom, when she like calls me at certain times, it instantly grounds me. And then like my dad sometimes has like timing that's like chilling. Like me and him are like, I'm convinced, are like psychically connected, but nevertheless, it just kind of reminds me of not only like the familial system, like the magic in the familial system, but even more so like kind of what you're speaking to, Adam, like this idea that our body on an individual level has these like mechanisms that create like and offer like coherence and cogency throughout our like circulation, throughout our breathing, throughout our all our different systems. But then I think about that in regards to like our relationships kind of almost acting like a sieve, if you will, for like spiritual like, you know, illness, maybe not like physical illness, but like, you know, some sort of like spiritual covering that's like offered through virtue of like relationships is like what's coming up for me right now.
Yes. And I love also like that you brought in this quality of like sometimes even just the sound and the sort of can be very grounding. Ooh. Yeah. I always feel like, Hoda, after you speak, I always feel like I need like a second to collect myself too. So I'm just like letting all that soak in. Yeah, and it's so fascinating to like just take notice of those things too. And I'm wondering, like, I'm kind of curious, have you ever mentioned to your mom or to your sister that they have this effect on you?
Yeah, I have. And it's funny because Tiff wrote in the chat that there is some family members that Tiff says make me need to ground myself. Yeah. Before I decide to interact. So like, there's also that too, where I'm like, I've also had like, because there are people who can deeply regulate me, I feel like by virtue of that, like in reference to what you said about like people coming together to like ripen karma earlier, for example, and like, they're also the people who like dysregulate me as well, like as like by the drop of a hat. So, yeah. But I have communicated it with them in general to let them know like, wow, I think that that's also kind of like the role that I play in my family. That I'm like a little bit of like bleeding heart poets. I always wear my heart on my sleeve. And so they're not as front facing with their emotions as much as I am. And so I'm always the one pouring my heart out. Like, do you know how much this conversation meant to me? And like, they're like, oh my God, I'm going to talk to you tomorrow. Relax. And I'm like, no, but you don't understand. So yeah.
That's amazing. I also think like, yeah, as someone that's pretty watery and fiery and airy, having those earth energies is so helpful. Oh my gosh. But yeah. And I think also like the emotional piece is really big. I also really like what you said about, for some reason, the way you said it, you didn't say this, but like, I was just thinking about some of the stuff that Nobu's talked about a lot too, about like he uses the word rupture a lot, right? Where it's like how those ruptures can really be formative moments, like really important pieces for us to like, for people that play these roles, especially to say, oh, there's a rupture here. How can I do some weaving? How can I sew this back together or help bring these pieces back together? And sometimes that's even us too. And we have to allow ourselves to get ruptured and to get dysregulated because maybe in the return to homeostasis, we're building new pathways, you know, if we're using the sort of neural language now, but like we're doing the reprogramming, right? With these returns to homeostasis, and every rupture is this opportunity to return. I remember this one coach I had where I was like, really going through my hardcore like spiritual phase with Christianity still, and was like really feeling guilty about not having the same like on fireness that I had in the beginning, right? Where I was just like living and breathing scripture and prayer and all this. And I was just like, I just lost it. Like, what's going on here? And was feeling really bad about it. And he said something that like really, I kind of was like, oh, that, I like that. Where it was sort of like, listen, every time you like step away from God, there's this beautiful door that's open to say, to step right back. It's like every time you walk away or cause a little separation, it's like now you have this beautiful opportunity to pull back in, to take a step forward again. And I always think about that too. And I think about that relationships too, where like there's a rupture and like so many of us are like, ah, you know, that's it, I'm done. And it's like usually the thing that we don't want to do is that step forward back to bring a sense of repair possibly. Ooh, you want to speak more to that, Tiff? Hoda says, makes me think of the wounds where the light shines in. And Tiff says, that's, I'm going to mispronounce this, so maybe I'll let someone else Tauba. Say it. Thank you, Tauba.
Yeah, so it's the idea that, like, I don't remember if this was in the Quran or Hadith, but, like, somebody said that if like, nobody ever did, like, okay, so there's the idea that sins take you away from God. So there was the idea that if nobody sinned anymore for, like, the rest of their lives, God would wipe out the entire population and create people that did sin because he likes when we ask for forgiveness. So it's like that idea, like, yeah, like you said, when you every time you step away, you get the beautiful opportunity to come back. So yeah, that's like, that's a thing that pops up in a lot of different sermons and stuff.
That's so beautiful. What a beautiful, wow. Oda says, returning to God is big in Islam, I feel. I mean, it's such a beautiful part to this whole thing, right? This return. And we talked about it even, I feel like, in the beginning with, like, even, like, the return to yourself, too, I think is very related. This return to God, return to self, like, the deeper part of ourself. I think they're very related. Wow.
Yeah, I did read in a book about Jewish mysticism that, like, you know, when you don't have, like, the words, like, it's okay to not have the words to say in prayer. This was something that was spoken about because it was like, well, even just, like, showing up and saying, I don't have the words, and like asking for the words, then that was a form of prayer too. Or saying, I don't know how to pray. Or like, can you show me how to pray? Because I don't know. That was like considered part of prayer itself, you know, because, and that was so helpful for me because I feel like that's been really big. Like sometimes like I'll go to pray and it's like I, or like, you know, it's like asking for the courage to speak at all, you know, or like, please, like, grant me the courage to speak my desire out loud, you know.
I love that. Yeah, Hoda's putting in the words like sincerity and receptivity, and I think those, yeah, it's like that authenticity too. Like there's no airs, right? Like just this is, you're bringing your full self and your most honest, authentic, deepest self in that moment to the relationship with God, with the divine, and or however, you know, you're doing that. And it's something so beautiful that happens in that moment that doesn't have to be like pitch perfect.
Exactly. Yeah. Or like even just saying like, I don't know.
Yes.
I don't know where to go, or like, I don't know which way to go. Like those have been some of the most.
Yes.
Like,
and maybe because
moments for me of just like when I don't know and I just like am really like honest about that, you know?
Yes. And for some reason, maybe because you mentioned Jewish mysticism, I'm just thinking of the Psalms, especially the ones that David, or that are attributed to David. Like David's Psalms are so beautiful. Like there's, but they're often like longing and pleading. They're not like these beautiful, like, God, you're the holiest of holies. And I mean, he does that too, but a lot of them are just like, what's going on, God? What's happening to me? Like, I'm screwed. Like, they're just like pleading. Like, they're just so raw and emotional and soulful. Yeah. And I love those Psalms.
That aligns. Cause also, like, you know, there is also like the idea in Judaism of like wrestling with God.
Yes. Yes, Jacob.
It's just like, yeah.
Yes.
It's not to be like this harmonious relationship all the time, you know?
Not at all. And he was given, you know, it was like he got two things, like right from that, right? Like he wrestled with the angel of God, and he comes out with a new name, Israel, and he also comes out with a gimpy walk now. You know, the angel touches his hip socket and is like, "You ain't walking the same anymore." And I think that's really powerful too. Like after this wrestle, you're not moving in the world the same way anymore. You've been touched by something close through this really raw wrestling. Mm. Hoda promised a meme, but she's not dropping it. Or maybe you wanted to speak to it, Hoda, if you want to. But it says, y'all, that reminds me of a meme. I'm sorry to take it there. There's no sense in not being sorry about this is the world we live in. Ah, the meme's coming. It's WikiHow. How to negotiate a higher salary? And it's someone just doing a really painful wrestling move. And as I do work in career development, and yeah, that's accurate. That's accurate. Oh, this says David to God. Come on, bring me closer, please. Oh, that's funny. That's so funny. Yeah. Yeah, they, you know, I just also want to go back to what you're saying, Anna, about like how the expectations of what prayer is supposed to look like also gets in the way. Like, I think that feels connected to other things we've been talking about like how these expectations in the field of projections, in the field of possibility can really mess up our potential. And 100%. Like, right?
Because yeah. I also, it's interesting because, like, you know, I grew up going to temple, and that was the only time that I prayed was when I was in temple. And it wasn't like I was praying from my heart necessarily. It was like, I was like, you know, I like memorized, mm-hmm. I didn't memorize, but I was like reading Hebrew, which is like pretty difficult if that's like your second language. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't like I had this muscle built of like, I'm speaking from my heart in, you know, in the comfort of my own space. I never did that. And so even now it's like, building that muscle is something that I'm still doing. And there's so many times where I just won't pray because I'm like, well, I'm not doing it right. Or, you know, a lot of times, like, it feels like it has to be like this really serious thing and it has to be so dramatic and like a prayer. And it's like, no, sometimes actually, like when I can just like be myself and I can actually just be silly about it, it works way better for me.
Same.
Like if I make it into this thing where I'm like, I have to like do this certain like ritual and I have to like speak and it has to be profound. And like sometimes it's just like that just like creates barriers, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Hoda says, when I can talk to the divine like the homie, then I'm in a good place.
Yes.
Me praying. Listen, babes. Literally. Listen up. I've got something to say.
Yes. 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 And I really think that that kind of a relationship is so beautiful. Like, it's so real. And who doesn't want a friend like that, you know? That's hilarious. Tiff says, I love a good Baptist deacon style prayer, but mostly I just talk like I do in my head. You know, that's the thing, like, it's all about, like we talked about, this sort of coming together of what's inside of us and what's out in the environment, and then they come together, and it might be a super earnest, deeply profound transmission, or it might just be some really silly kind of relating that's just happening on a funny level. It really just depends on where that's at and this coming together, this communication being facilitated.
Yeah, it's not to say that, like, there aren't moments where, like, I do have,
yeah,
you know, I experience, like, profundity. Is that the word?
Yeah.
When I'm
even praying. When you said it, it sounds like profundity, you know.
Like, yeah, sometimes that does happen, or like sometimes I will shed tears, but that's not like always the case, because just like human relationships, our relationship to the divine is not static. It's not like we show up in the same way every single day, because you wouldn't do that with your friend. So why would you wouldn't do that with yourself?
Mm-mm. You know, absolutely. And some of us, you know, we're sensitive to our environments. We're receiving all the time. And so, like, yeah, the cosmic weather, the environmental weather, the things that are happening, like, they're going to bring out different aspects of us, because some of us are just really sensitive to it. And some of us are sensitive to it and unconsciously sensitive to it. And so, yeah, we're not going to be the same. Like, that sort of stable self was one of the biggest egregores I feel like I had to really tackle in my life in order to advance, especially when it comes to, like, spiritual progression or whatever. I don't even think progression is not even the right word, right? That's still part of that egregore. Like, spiritual development, you know, getting in touch with my own sort of intuitive system and how I operate and how I sort of have this relationship with spirit in all of its forms. And, like, I really had to go against this egregore of, like, oh, I just need to get to a place where there's sort of stability in the personality, or stability in the my sense of self. And it's like, that's so boring, though. Like, why was I shooting for that? And it was just coming from, I think, stuff I had read or stuff that I thought, like, the expectations, oh, I think you're supposed to do this, or that's somehow an indicator of something that's worthwhile. And I really was like, but is it? Let me actually, like, go in and ask myself, is that really what I want? And I was like, no, I don't. And also, I don't even think it's real anyway. I don't know if anyone else has had to overcome that sort of desire for sort of a sense of, like, a stable self or something.
Yeah, I feel like I'm working through that.
Yeah. Well, you just said the same thing.
I couldn't say that I overcame that. I have not.
Yeah, it's one of those, like, it might be one of those lifelong goals.
Yeah. For me, it does feel like a lifelong thing. Like, what even is, it's overcoming me, let's be fair. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, man. And also just, like, when you think about, like, stability, you think of stagnation too. It's not moving. Like, I think we're here in this realm of separation to move. That's
interesting. Yeah. Does stability mean stagnation? I don't think it does personally, but I could see how you might interpret it like that.
Yeah. I don't think it has to mean it.
Yeah. But I feel like if it does, then, like, that's just so interesting to think about.
Yeah. And I mean, I also, like, went down to, like, the biology of it too, and I was like, but what is this self that's stable? Like, if we go to the physical realm, when is it ever, we're always in the process of decaying and rebirthing, right? There's cells that are dying, cells that are being born, blood that's being, you know, taken out, blood that's being remade, water coming in, water coming out, you know, like, all these elements that make up new food, and then being wasted. Like, we're constantly a new organism every second. So why would we be trying to fight against the fact that we're always a evolving, ever moving organism?
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, that's a, if you feel like jumping off of mute, please do hold it. But she said she's reading a book called Technosis that has something to do with this dynamic we're talking about now.
Ooh. I would also love to hear from Tiff about this.
Yeah, I was going to say that. Like, I'm also holding space if Tiff wants to expand, but it also relates a little bit to, yeah, this concept of, like, the modern stable self, which I'll put a pin in and I'll come back to.
Yeah, Tiff, please.
All right, yeah. So, like, I always think about when the people around me are talking about stability, they usually mean like financial stability. And I'm like, you know, not, I work sometimes and I don't work sometimes, and I get money and sometimes it's enough to save and sometimes I be broke. So I'm like, all right, I'm not really what you'd call financially stable. And then, so I like redefined it. Like, am I really like, did I pay my phone bill? Can I, like, do I still got a roof over my head because I live with people. So, like, essentially, I was just like, all right, I got to find where am I stable at? So, like, okay, maybe my finances are not stable, but, like, is my soul stable? Like, I just got to go on a deeper level. Like, where is the stability in me? Because it's got to exist somewhere, even if my life doesn't reflect it necessarily. But yeah, I'm like, okay, I just find, like, what's, you know, that inner self that is always stable, like the part of you that's untouchable, you know, like your deepest soul, like that's stable. And then, like, try to expand out from that, like, okay, maybe is okay, so what's around that, like my heart, my body, my emotions, my thoughts, like all these other things. So yeah, like in trip, like Hoda said, where can I anchor in myself? So I'm like looking for an anchor point. And maybe, like, what's a stable, like it's like a built something that can stand, or like it's a place where you can hold your horses, you know. Or, you know, sumo wrestling, they got their stables. It's something to hold on to. So, yeah, an anchor point, essentially. Or, like, you know, if I can't be stable because I'm a ship and I'm floating, well, I can drop that anchor to the sea floor. The sea floor is always down there somewhere. And, yeah, so just, like, find a different place, something else to be stabled on. But now that y'all bring this up of, like, yeah, maybe you won't be stable. That's okay, too. So everybody's working on overcoming it over some time. I am today years old. I might see what that's like just to not be stable. But I'm going to be a little stable because unstable Tiff is no fun for everybody.
Yeah, Tiff, I appreciate you speaking to that, because I feel like for me what's coming up is, like, the self is a fluid thing. And, like, because the self, especially with the world that we live in, kind of, like, nowadays, is, like, there are many selves that we are responsible for, I guess you can say. Like, what comes up for me is, like, the self that I am at the grocery store, the self that I am at the house, the self that I am on this call. It's not that they're separate selves. They're just different, like, chords within the larger instrument of me that I'm, like, playing for different reasons, for different contexts. And so, like, I feel like that really aligns for me, because, like, yeah, I was saying in the chat how sometimes in the context that it shows up for me most in is, like, when I'm meditating, because I'm like, how do I ground? Like, laughing at Tiff's comment right now. Tiff says, speaking of unstable, Adam's Discord connection. I'm dead. But yeah, to that point about like how or where directionality, I guess you could speak, is really important. I guess you can say is really important for me when it comes to meditation, because, like, it's not always my root chakra when it comes to, like, grounding. Like, sometimes, like, my heart is taking up a lot of space in my aura. and I need to like kind of like station it a little bit more because it's like wobbling in a certain way, or like sometimes my crown is like a little off kilter and then I need to like kind of do some movements or like some singing or like some breathing to like bring it to a place that doesn't necessarily feel like grounded into the earth. But I like that the word that we're using is stable, and I think that I'm also, what's coming up for me too is like Adam's association with it being like representing something as static, and then the association we also have to it relating to like fiscal stability, I think is like is very telling about how most people find stability in current time, which is like having a job that they report to at a certain time every day, or a school or something that they report to at a certain time every day. And even if it's not like through fiscal stability, it's also through like spending. I mean, it is fiscal through spending, but it also makes me think of like people who have to answer to like family timelines and all those sort of things, I think are so many different contexts where maybe like the way that we see our self-expressing stability not only can change or can be, I think what Tiff said, like transformed is, I don't know if that's the word they use, I'm paraphrasing, but that's what came up for me when you were speaking, is like we can transform how we access stability. Yeah, Anna's saying external stability can probably be replaced with internal stability. Or there can be a more mutual exchange between how we obtain external stability and like how that reflects our internal stability, perhaps. Because, yeah, I'm kind of seeing the word stability in a new way now.
Yes, I appreciate the like the way that we've really been looking at this word from multiple, this concept, this archetype, even from multiple angles. I'm so grateful you brought that material piece in. And it's funny, Tip, because when I do my work on like the career counseling side, that's the number one thing people say. Like when it's like, what do you want? Like, you know, I don't try to usually ask it that way, but it, you know, shorthand, that's like the thing that we're looking for. Like, what are you looking for? What are you trying to do? And the most common response is, I'm looking for stability. And I think, yeah, they're talking about what you're talking about. And I love what you're saying, Hoda, about like transforming that. And also like, how can we transform? I think you use the word like how we access stability. Like that is a really powerful thing to think about, where it's like, this access to me, like I like you said, I think coming to this point of like, okay, maybe the ground that I'm standing on feels unstable. Can I find something else to ground into, to anchor into, to use that word? Like that the stability, yeah, it's almost like what we're pointing to, the stability, it's like this combination again of 333 from where you're at, but like to me it feels like there's still the same combination of what we've been dancing around, which is like this, these things that are true for who I am in my deepest self, and the environment and the context I find myself, and how do I stay connected to those two things. Like am I both in my own sort of inner integrity and kind of have the ability and have the sort of internal coordination to allow my authentic expression, and am I really enough tuned in to the actual moment, to the real here and now, right now, and can I be both attuned to what's going on within me and where I'm at and kind of have that, and attuned to what's actually happening outside in my environment, and can I bring them together? That might bring some kind of fun novelty to the world, or joy, or whatever it is you're trying to do, or rupture for repair, like we talked about, to return, to do some bridge work. Wow. Yeah, stability. This feels like there's more here even, but I love this gift Hoda has of us, like us with the word stability, and it's like a hyperspace tunnel, and we're flying through this thing, looking out the window, like whoa, it's crazy out here.
I do.
But it is. What's that?
I was just gonna say that I do feel like stability can be found in like what we choose to see. And like what we commit to seeing, which makes it easier for me because, I mean, I don't know about y'all, but like when I wake up in the morning, it's really like, it can be a grab bag about like how I'm feeling in my body. Like it really, really fucking depends. But like, and so I really can't rely on that, I found, for stability, because I guess like in trying to find internal stability, I thought maybe like I might be able to rely on that, but that has not been the case. And so lately I've been trying to tune into like, well, what, like, how do I want to feel instead of like, how am I actually feeling presently? Like, I'm gonna honor how I'm feeling presently, but like, it's just way interesting. I'm reading the chat. It's just way more, it's way more effective for me to be like, you know, day after day, like, what am I dedicated to perceiving? Like, what do I actually want to perceive? Like, do I want to perceive love? Do I want to feel gratitude? Then like, okay, that's going to be my anchor then. Cause I can't rely on like my body to just like naturally be in like one, like state, you know, like it just really.
Yeah, I do. I think I'm picking up what you're putting down here. And I feel like the word that came to me when you were speaking was attunement. Like,
exactly. Cause like I could sit here and like, if I'm attuned to misery, then that's what the fuck I'm gonna feel.
Yeah, yeah. If my radio is set to the frequency of misery, yeah, that's the song that's gonna keep playing.
And it's like, God, this, hearing myself say this is like, honestly, there's a part of me that's like, really, like I'm so annoyed by it, but it's like. Unfortunately, I think it's very true for me.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those things where like we talked about earlier, I feel like we're talking about full range of humanity. It's not going to be an easy soundbite, because like, I think what, I don't know if I'm right, but Anna, I think what you're pointing to is like how trite and sort of like almost like toxic positivity can sound, like where it's like,
yeah, it really can.
You want, you know, yeah, so I get that, but that's not what you're saying. You're saying it, yeah, in a, I don't, in a bigger context here.
Yeah, I don't think it's like, because also I don't think like gratitude is like bypassing.
No, I don't think so either.
And I've had to like toe that line for myself a lot. Because there are moments where I will like, you know, be attuning myself and I'm like, am I bypassing right now?
Yeah. I think this, it's a fair question of like that sort of fine line that goes through that attunement process, and sort of like we've used the word, like, you know, what situations, when is it appropriate or not appropriate or healthy or helpful or not helpful to play with the Lulu, turn up the Lulu or to turn it down. This is, that's my silly cheeky way of speaking to what you're talking about with the bypassing, right? Of like, I'm going to, yeah, going to like get like where it becomes a distraction. It's not actually like trying to receive a frequency. Because I think that's the big difference too, where it's like, I'm going to pretend like it. So like, it's like the idea, difference between like fake it till you make it and actual attunement. Like if we were to use the metaphor of like, yeah, I can play, like I can artificially create a song, but like what we're talking about is like really tuning the instrument so that, you know, the real authentic frequency can come through.
Mm.
I got mixed up in my metaphor. Yeah.
Tuning the instrument. I really like that. Because it's, because tuning the instrument would include paying attention to like, if it sounds out of tune, right? You can't tune it if you're not keyed into that.
Yes. You have to actually play it. That's true. Yeah. But then every once in a while you're tuned in a weird key and it's cool. Right? We've heard those recordings where it's like, there's a couple of my favorite like Beatles tracks where like the like Lady Madonna, that piano's out of tune, but it works. Sorry. Yeah. I like what you're saying about this attunement, though. And Tiff, yeah, like, am I being genuinely grateful for something or just gaslighting myself in misery with, well, at least. Yeah. Yeah, and it's like, it's one of those things where, like, when they say see the bright side of it, and, like, you could say, like, you could see how, like, that's really quite dangerous advice if you not really know what that's pointing to. Because you'd be like, just look at the bright side of everything. And it's like, dude, you're going to really set yourself up for failure if you're not seeing the whole picture, right? You need to see everything. But I think what that saying is also drawing our attention to is, like, when we are on our pity parade, we do not see the things that are things that are worthy of gratitude, are things that are our assets. Like, I find that to be the case when people are in a catastrophe, they don't always have the ability to like take stock of like, wow, I have this, I have that, I have this, I have that. And it's not just an exercise of like, oh, let me just be grateful that I have this body. You know, it's more like, what are the actual things that I have in front of me that I can use to get out of this problem? I have a mind that still can work. I have a body that can still move. These are not small things. These are big things. They're not little things. Hoda says, yes, you have to sometimes, for me, come back to the basics. I completely agree. I completely agree. Especially when you're... Yeah. Go ahead, Anna, please.
I was just going to say, especially when it comes to, like, being grateful, you know? Mm-hmm. Just being like, hey, mm-hmm. Well, I can walk.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, like, yeah, Hoda's saying, like, I have a roof over my head. I have food. That's where I start sometimes when I'm lost. I'm like, I'm breathing. Like, I have breath in my body right now.
Yes.
You know, yes. Like, my fingers are moving. And that's where I start, or that's where I try and start.
Yes. I remember when I first started hearing that phrase of like, he woke me up today. You know, it was like, I woke up, didn't I? I'm not underground. Well, I always ask people, how are you doing today? I'm alive. I'd be like, well, that's an interesting thing to say. And then after a while, I was like, yeah. Fuck yeah, I'm alive. Yeah. Won't he? Yes. Won't she will? That's right. Exactly, Hoda. Mm-hmm. Yes, I was saying, remember the time you lived in your car. Remember the time you worked at that one place. Is this not better? Well, all right then. All right then. And not only are you not that person in that situation, you're that person that overcame that situation and learned all kinds of new skills. You learned all kinds of new resiliency tools. You got all that. You came out of that. So, whoa, let's not forget about that. Let's not forget about all those strategies that we've already uncovered. And we've already sort of, we have muscle memory around some of those strategies. We can tap back into that intelligence. We survived that. We can survive this. Amen, Tiff.
And just to like bring it back to Saturn quickly. Because I feel like, you know, we've been talking about Saturn. And for me, doing Saturn work, like, you have to take time to celebrate or else it's really impossible to do that hard work. Like, if you're not taking time to congratulate yourself and, like, celebrate how far you've come, then it can be really difficult, you know?
Yes. I'm really glad you brought Saturn back into the container because I also feel like the beautiful thing about Saturn that I've always loved, and I got this especially from like the Yotish tradition, where it's like the gifts you get from Saturn do not go away. They are not these ephemeral little like blessings, right? Because it's the Saturn energy that, like we were talking about, like we come out with a new resiliency strategy. We come out with new ways of being and moving. Like, it's hard won. We've worked at it. We've put it into our body intelligence. Like I said, the muscle memory, like that feels kind of Saturnian, where it's like not this necessarily this big, huge, amazing thing, right? It's all the small things that now become second nature to us because we put in the hours, those 10,000 hours, to use that archetype from Malcolm Gladwell.
Yeah. In the chat, I put that like the gifts that we get hold a lot of weight.
Yes. Yes. They do. Whew. Well, I want to be mindful of time. This has been such a fun conversation, though. And I want to just maybe, like, give us all an opportunity to try to synthesize what we feel like might be an interesting takeaway or what we might want to take away from this conversation. And I'm going to ask myself that now, too. But would love for people to either share in the chat or come off mute and what you might be like, I think I'm going to take this away, or I'm going to sit with this, or yeah, anything.
Well, I will think about summarizing it all. What I got is, we are prepping the chef work, and then we are being stable, and we're trying to find our connections to stability and return to source. And what else we talked about? I feel like everything connected in a way. Well, it did. We all would just jump off from one point to another, but mainly, it's all about, it all comes back to grounding and being present and applying yourself by being present and grounded.
Woo. Amen. Present and grounded. Yes. Yes. I'm going to hold space as I kind of allow what wants to come up for me too. But yeah, anyone else that wants to jump in, please do. Woo.
I think what I'll say is what I said in the chat, that I'm along with what Tiff said, because yeah, that kind of culminates some of my like takeaways as well. But yeah, I'm going to probably investigate and feel into the possibility of making an offering to Saturn, because it was just so loud. So yeah, and I want to just say out loud, thank you, Adam, for this space, and thank you all for an amazing conversation.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm feeling that Saturn offering too. Yeah. Oh man, I've got something that's coming up that's like, I think it's a synthesis, but it might be an addition, so I'm trying not to add because there's been so much. But yeah, it's Saturn in the room with us right now, it feels, and I'm with you on that. Yeah, I mean, I think for some reason, yes, thank you. And actually, let me, Anna, do you have anything you want to add before I start going off on a quick rant?
I mean, not really. It was kind of a joke, but I feel like in some containers, like, you know, we'll be like communing with a certain energy and we'll be like, yeah, is blank in the room with us right now?
I think it's true, though. I didn't like what it said. I feel like Saturn, and I feel like it was beautiful because Saturn, I think, wanted to be in the container. And I think that we were really giving Saturn its flowers.
Yeah, we were ready. I feel like we've been ready too, because it's come up. I feel like we've been talking about Saturn, like we, you know, me, you, and Hoda had that conversation a couple days ago too.
Mm-hmm.
And then, yeah, and then Chris was channeling Saturn, and it was just like, okay. Yeah, it was really beautiful how everything has unfolded. Yeah.
Yeah. And I feel like for some reason, like, I'm trying to find the words for it, but like the image that came up, and it's very Saturnian too in its way, is I was just thinking about like this. My big takeaway was this conversation around like your potential. Like that really is staying with me. And I guess I'm thinking of potential as like, now I'm thinking of as almost like these shapes of potential in the quantum field and this sort of harmonizing and alignment. And I see Saturn as this beautiful energy that's like, it's like in a, it's like if we were to use like a musical metaphor or like an archer or like a marksman, where it's like, hold on, let these shapes take their shape, do your work, like basically wait, and then you'll know the moment when finally your shape is right in that same, you've got that shape in the right place so that it matches with that other shape in the potential field, and we got something. We got something lasting. We got something new. This new channel of information, this new flow of energy from the spiritual to the material, right? And that's what came up for me. And I see Saturn as that one that's like, hold fast. Don't take your shot. Wait. Get it right. Get your geometries right. Yes. Tiff says, knowing the right time to take shape is a banger. Yeah. And I feel like that's some of the energy I'm feeling from this conversation right now. And that's what I'm taking away of, like, have I been jumping the gun a little bit? Have I not really allowed myself to really get into the right shape and to really pay attention and perceive the shapes in the field that where there's some really beautiful harmonic potential? And yes, I want to also thank everybody. Like, this has been one of my favorite conversations. Everyone brought such unique perspectives, and yet it all came together. It all flowed beautifully. And I'm really grateful for this. And I'm really grateful for this opportunity to have conversations like this with really interesting, genuine, authentic people. So thank you, guys. Thank you all so much. And thank you for anyone that's joined asynchronously. And I hope if you did, you'll share your thoughts on these things, too, in the Broom Discord or wherever you might find this recording. Thank you all.